We're going to think about current and circuits and resistance, but this time what we're going to do is think about them at a micro level, and then we're going to try to make a connection between what's going on at the micro level and at the macro level. Now, when we think about circuits in the lab, we're usually thinking at the macro level. We're talking about batteries and wires and resistors, things that we can see. And then we measure the current and the voltage and the resistance as meterable phenomena. Even though we know that there is something going on at the minute level, we don't worry about the behavior of individual charge carriers. We just say, hey, how much current is flowing? I'll just grab my ammeter and measure it. Now, we know that if we impose some potential difference, we can measure current. And one mental construct to account for these observations would be that voltage causes current to flow through a resistance. But now let's think about what's going on inside the wires. Something causes the presence of an electrical field in the wire. In this case, that's going to be the battery. And this E field is going to push on the charges already present in the wire, causing them to move. And in order to describe this whole bunch of moving charges, we're going to invent something called the current density, or J. The amount of J that we get, that is, how much current density results from a given E field strength, is actually going to depend on the material that the current is trying to move through. If the material holds back the movement of charge, then we say it has a high resistivity. If it lets a lot of charge move through, then the material has a low resistivity. The implied mental construct here is that the presence of an electric field causes current density, with the magnitude of the current density depending on rho, the resistivity of the material. Now, if Ohm's law describes the relationship between the macroscopic behavior of voltage and current and resistance, then this expression, J equals E over rho, describes what is happening at the micro level. We'll come back and talk about this in detail, but now might be a good time to pause the video and get something to take a few notes with. Okay, in order to make sense of resistivity, we're going to start by cooking up some resistors. A cooking project is always nice when you're stuck in the house, and since I happen to be stuck in the house, literally, let's cook resistors. We're going to make our resistors out of Play-Doh, and again, since we're stuck in the house, we'll make homemade Play-Doh instead of using the commercial stuff. Here's the deal. You take 2 cups of flour and 2 cups of warm water and 1 cup of salt, and that's a lot of salt. You're really not going to want to eat this Play-Doh. And some cooking oil, and I hear that 1 tablespoon of cream of tartar makes a silkier Play-Doh, but we don't have any in the house, so we'll just mix up what we have and we'll put it on the stove. And then we heat it until it's about the consistency of mashed potatoes, and it's time to take it off the stove and knead it and add food coloring. The whole idea is to make resistors here. Salt and water. There's a nice electrolyte here suspended in some oily starch, right? So we're gonna roll these babies in some tubes, like this, and hey, resistors. Now, here's the question. How do you expect these resistors to behave? Based on what you've seen, I want you to make a prediction. Please rank order our Play-Doh resistors. Which one do you think will have the lowest electrical resistance? Which is next higher than that? And which is the highest? Pause the video and write down your predictions. And yeah, fair enough. We're gonna assume that the different colors don't have any impact on resistivity or resistance. Okay, so let's talk about how current looks from right up close. To do that, we have to ask an important question. What exactly is it that moves when current flows? There are a number of possibilities. If positives flow to the right, then the right-hand end of the conductor becomes positive and the left becomes negative. Interestingly enough, we can get precisely the same effect by moving negatives to the left, or by doing both things at once. So which is it? It's not immediately obvious what experiment you could do that would test the competing possibilities. Ben Franklin sometimes gets blamed for sticking us with the idea that it's the positives that move, but honestly, I have no idea if there's any historical fairness to that or not. I do know that in his era, it still wasn't completely clear what electricity actually was. I do know that if I wake up tomorrow morning in a state of existential doubt over whether it really is tiny little pluses or tiny little minuses moving around in a circuit, I will head to the lab and I'll reconvince myself with the Hall effect, discovered by Edwin Hall long after Franklin's death. As far as I know, it wasn't actually until 1879 that the question was settled decisively. What exactly is the Hall effect? Well, sorry, this is a topic for another day, but soon enough. While it was finally established that in ordinary electrical circuits it's the negative stuff that moves, a lot of important work got done on understanding electrical currents before that time, and in fact it turns out that from a macroscopic perspective it often doesn't matter which is moving. Enter the idea of conventional current. A representation of current as having the direction that positive charges would have if in fact it were their movement causing the current. Now, it may be that we're stuck with Franklin's idea embedded in our formalism, but what matters is that we have a convention. If a stream of negative ions is shooting off to the left, we would still represent it with a current I to the right. When current flows in salt water, positive ions and negative ions move in opposite directions. We still say the current is in the direction moved by the positives. Ice is actually a proton conductor. Currents go through ice by the motion of hydrogen atoms. But in any case, this formalism of conventional current allows us to make predictions that happily still tend to be confirmed by experiment without worrying about what it actually is that's moving. So it's usually negatives that move, but we pretend that it's positives. Okay, let's see if we can further declarify this situation by talking about how the charges flow. Because actually, the problem is that they don't flow. That is to say, charges in a circuit don't move in an orderly way. Charges actually move thermally, that is to say, randomly, at random speeds and random directions, just like the molecules in a gas. However, once an electric field is imposed, the movement of the charges are biased. Every movement that would have happened before gets nudged downstream a little. In fact, the paths have tiny curvature to them. Each step is a little further because the tiny influence of the bias adds up over time until we see clearly after a number of steps that even as the particle jumps about, it is, in effect, slowly drifting downstream in the electric field. We use the term drift velocity to refer to this net movement imposed on random noise. Now, to give you a sense of scale, in a household circuit, the mean speed of electrons might be on the order of 100,000 meters per second, but the drift velocity less than a centimeter per second. Sometime soon, you should explain all of this to someone who's younger than you are. They will look at you funny and ask, if the electrons travel so slowly, how come I can flip the switch on the wall over here and the lights turn on like wham over there? Now, if you can dig yourself out of that one, you are ready to go on with this video. So, if the charges are just bopping around like that, do we have a totally chaotic picture of current at the micro scale? In fact, we don't, and it probably won't surprise you that we can successfully idealize all this wacky behavior into some manageable vector fields. Let's remember that our goal is to describe current, and that current is the rate at which charges pass by a place in the conductor. The charges may in fact be bopping all over, but we can describe the net motion of charge with flow lines, like in a fluid. Just as with an incompressible fluid, we can learn a lot by looking at the flow lines of charge. Remember back at the beginning we mentioned current density? Those flow lines represent current density, the density with which charges pass through the conducting material. You can picture the flow lines passing through a cross-section of the material. And if this didn't already look enough like flux, we can look at each tiny sub-area of the cross-section, ask what the current density is at that place and determine how much that tiny current flux contributes to the overall current. Now, to find the whole current, we just add up all those contributions. To make this computation tractable, we make some assumptions that should sound familiar. Let's say, for the sake of argument, that the current density is uniform in magnitude over the whole surface and everywhere perpendicular to the surface. Well, that would allow us to pull the magnitude of the current density out of the integral. Bam! Adding up all the differential areas is trivial, and now we can really say what we mean by current density. It's the current over the area. Okay, we have a lot of balls in the air right now. Current density, drift velocity. How do these two things connect? Let's see if we can relate the two. Let's look at some wire and a section of that wire with length L. Inside that wire, there are a number of charge carriers equal to the density of charge carriers times the volume of the section. The total charge of the charge carriers is the number of carriers times the charge on each one. And here we're going to use the fundamental charge E, the charge on an electron. The current I is the charge per unit time crossing the surface. And now we should have all the pieces in place to connect drift velocity with current density. This is a worthy exercise if you want to pause the video now and work it out on your own. Or you can just hang on and we'll go through it quickly here. I just want to be clear. You do not have to be able to reproduce this argument. Okay, to know current, we need Q and T, and we have an expression for Q. How about T? How long will it take all those charges to cross the surface? Well, if they move at drift velocity V sub D, we can find out the time for it takes the that we can find the time it takes for them to travel the distance L. Now, we know the charge that passes, and we know the time it takes to pass, and we can substitute those values in. We can then cancel out the L's, and solve for V sub D, and we get this. But we already said that I over A is J. So now we can finally relate J to the drift velocity like this. Again, you do not have to be able to reproduce this argument, but it's worth seeing the connection between drift velocity and current density. Current density is just the charge that's moving, or the density of the charge that's moving, which is to say N, the density of charges per unit volume, times E, the charge on each one of those carriers, times their mean speed, the drift velocity d, which of course is the aggregate of lots and lots of random movements that are slightly biased in the direction of the electric field. Okay, let's see if we can bring this home. We have two ways to look at current. Ohm's law and its micro cousin, the relationship between electric field and current density, which is really just the definition of resistivity. To rewrite this, we could say that a uniform electric field is the voltage over the length, and we also defined the current density as I over A. But there's a V over I in there, and that's Ohm's law for R. And we can solve this result for R like so. And this is what we came for, people. It hasn't been pretty, but for us at the moment, this equation is the most important takeaway. This is the equation you need to write down in big black magic marker with gold leaf and curlicues. We can relate the micro behavior, the resistance in ohms of any resistor, to the micro characteristics, the inherent resistivity of the material from which it's made, and the geometry. The length part should make sense to you. It's like adding more resistors in series. If we have more of it, we have more resistance. But why is R inversely proportional to area? You can think of it in terms of adding resistance in parallel, or you can picture the current density. If we have this current density in one resistor, how would it look different with a bigger cross-section? Well, the current density is clearly lower here. And this would have to rise until it's compatible with the electric field. And that's going to give us more current. If we have more current, there must have been less resistance. let's go back to where we started. Look at the ranking that you gave the Play-Doh resistors. If you want to revise your predictions based on what you know now, feel free to do that. And then after a pause, we'll look at the actual metered resistance values for the Play-Doh. Ready? Let's look at the results.
Put the end caps on. Just put the end caps on. There's the
So, how'd you do? Based on the data, do you think you could compute the resistivity of Play-Doh? Okay, so the Play-Doh is not perfectly homogeneous, but you could probably come up with a ballpark figure. This relationship looks simple, but it would also permit you to compute the resistors made in wackier shapes, shapes that are not right prisms. The approach is to take the resistor and to divide it up into subunits, each with infinitesimal resistance, and to sum up those like resistors in series. Well, that's it, folks. We have the macro world, in which we are concerned with the meterable values of current, voltage, and resistance. And we have the micro world, in which current density results from electric field mediated by the resistivity of the material and the connections between these two worlds. Da 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 da